Good morning. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, Mission Ebenezer Family Church. Good to be here this morning with you on this glorious day that the Lord has made. We get to rejoice, be glad in it. Here we go. Okay. Took a little bit to warm up, but it moved through the crowd. You know, the church, as amazing as it is so many things. But one of the central things is that it is an opportunity for us to recognize the glory of the Lord in our midst, the existence of the greatest source of creation is right here, and we have this great opportunity to be grounded in that worship. And I don't know where you're coming from as you gather here. I'm kind of still figuring out where I'm coming from as I'm here. I just know it's the right place to be. I know that wherever you're coming from today, if your heart is full of joy and celebration, praise the Lord and bring us there with you. If your heart is broken up in pieces or has a film of guilt on it, all I know is that you're here in the right place this morning on this great day that we have to worship together. And what I do know is the word says that God inhabits the praises of his people. So wherever you feel in relationship to God, as we begin to worship together, there is truth in the fact that God's presence is right here in you, in me, and in what we're about today. So I'm going to open us up in prayer. I'll ask if you could stand where you're at, if able, and we will then move into time with Nena leading us in our song, our hope, our praise together. And so, Jesus, you are here in our midst, and we are pausing for a moment to call upon your name, the name above every name, to call upon the Spirit that has been given to us as a gift that falls upon us this morning as we look to open up our hearts and worship, adore, and magnify your presence in our lives and in this world. The gift of love, the call upon us to be in a place where we recognize your sovereignty in our life and in this world. God, we kneel before you in a way this morning in humble gratitude, with that sense of appreciation to have another day, to be in the midst of a world that's going through so much and always is, but we know that you do not change and that you love when your people gather together and lift you up and recognize that you are the source of our life, the giver of our life, the one who is with us through all things. So as you are with us this morning, what a blessing we have to be in such good company. And so as the brothers and sisters of Mission Ebenezer Family Church come to lift you up, may you bless and anoint everything that happens here today. And we pray this in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Amen. We're going to join all of creation in blessing the name of our Lord today. It's so good to be in the house of God with you. It's better to be in the house of the Lord than anywhere else. And so, God, we enter into your gates with thanksgiving in our heart. We come into your courts with praise and declare that you are here, that you are with us, and that you are worthy to be praised. Amen? Come on, let's put our hands together. God, we thank you and we honor you. We're going to sing Every Praise Is to Our God. Amen.
Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise glory, praise is to our God.
Come on, let's sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah to our God. Glory, hallelujah is to our God. Every praise is to our God.
Come on, let's sing every praise is to our God.
Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah to our God. Glory, hallelujah is to our God. Every praise is to our God. We declare he's our Savior, God, my Savior, God, my healer, God, my deliverer. Yes, he is. Yes, come on, declare that with us. God, my Savior, God, my healer, God, my deliverer.
Yes, Lord, we lift up our hands. We lift up our voice in praise to you. Thank you for being the lifter of our head. Thank you for being our very present help in time of need. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for refining us and purifying us. You are the potter, Lord, and we are the clay. You mold us and you make us. new every single day. How many of you are grateful for the new creation that you are in Christ? Because of God, we are here. Because of his love and how he refines us day after day. God, your mercies for us are new every single morning. And we meet you here. We thank you, God. We just want to encourage you to lift up your hands with us right now if you're able. Lord, fill us. Fill this place. Fill our hearts. Cover us how you cover us, God. How you fill our hearts, Lord. How you give us peace that surpasses all understanding. In time of turmoil, in the middle of the storm, we are comforted by your hand. And we are given your peace day after day. Thank you, Father, for that precious gift. If the altar's where you meet us, take me there, take me there. If you're looking for an offering, it's right here. My life is here, and I'll be a living sacrifice for you. You're a fire, the refiner. I want to be consumed. I want to be tried by fire. Purified. You take whatever you desire. Lord, here's my life. I want to be tried by fire. Purified. You take whatever you desire. Lord, here's my life. If your glory wants to come in, let it fall. We want it all. Lord, your fire is consuming. Fill this place, set it ablaze, and I'll be a living sacrifice. You're a fire, the refiner. I want to be consumed. I want to be tried by fire. Purify. You take whatever you desire. Lord, here's my life. I want to be tried by fire. So clean my hands, purify my heart. I want to burn for you only. Come on, let's sing, clean my hands. So clean my hands, purify my heart. I want to burn for you. Refiner.
be tried by fire. Purified, you take whatever you desire. Lord, here's my life. I want to be tried by fire. Purified, you take whatever you desire. Lord, here's, sing that one last time. I want to be tried by fire. Purified, you take whatever you desire. Lord, here's my life.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We bless you, Lord. We bless your name this morning. We thank you, mighty God. We thank you that you are. You are refining fire in our lives. We thank you, Father, that you know exactly what belongs and what doesn't. You know what's gold and what is dross. You know what's wheat and what is chaff. You know what belongs and what doesn't. When we don't know, you know. When we're confused, you are certain. And when we need you, you are there to strip away the things from us that don't belong. The sin that doesn't belong there. The bitterness that doesn't belong there. The hatred that doesn't belong there. The fear, the shame that doesn't belong there. You are a refining fire to melt away that which doesn't belong. We give ourselves to you, Lord. Wholly unto you. Have your way in us. If there's anything in me, Lord, that is not what it needs to be, Lord, I give you permission right now to enter in and to make me who you want me to be. It might hurt. It might sting a little bit. Might not feel good. Might feel like pruning. Might feel like a refining process. But Lord, you know what's best for my life and not me. And so we offer ourselves unto you. Have your way in us. Church, would you repeat that with me this morning as we continue in this spirit of worship? Would you just simply say unto the Lord, not to me, not to Nena, not to the worship team, not to the pastoral staff of this church, but between you and God, just let them know, here I am, Lord, I'm yours. Have your way in me. Here I am, Lord, I am yours. Man, that's a dangerous but a beautiful thing to say. Here I am, Lord, I am yours. Have your way in me. Make me more and more like you. We need you, Lord. Holy Spirit, we need you. Come and fill this place. Blow through the caverns of our soul, transforming us into the men and women that you've called us to be. As uncomfortable as it may be, we welcome you to transform us, to reshape us, to mold us. Have your way in us, oh Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just present yourself before the Lord, between you and God right there. If you want to close your eyes because it helps you to avoid distraction, then by all means, whatever it takes between you and your God, why don't you present yourself unto the Lord right now? Present yourself unto the Lord. You can't control the person next to you, whether or not you like that, whether you think you can or you can't. But what you can control is the decision that you make between you and your Heavenly Father. And you can make a decision today to simply say, here I am, Lord, I am yours. You know what I did. You know what I said. You know the sins that I've committed. You know the things that I haven't done that I should have done. And I'm bringing that before you, Lord, and I'm offering that to you before you. Have your way in me, Heavenly Father.
Clean my hands, purify my heart. I want to burn for you, only. Sacrifice, I want to burn for you. Only
sing it again. Clean my hands and purify my heart.
Clean my hands, purify my
heart. Tell him I want to burn for you.
I want to burn
only for you.
Only
this verse says, take my life as a living sacrifice.
Take my life
as a sacrifice.
As a sacrifice.
So I want to burn for you, Lord.
Burn
only for you.
For you. Only
sing that again. Clean
you.
My hands. Purify my heart.
Clean my hands. Purify my heart. I want to burn for you. Only
take
for
my
you.
Life as a sacrifice.
And take my life as a sacrifice. I want to burn for you. Only for you. Purify the refiner. I want to be consumed. I want to be tried by fire. Take whatever you desire. Lord, here's my life. I want to be tried by fire. Purified. You take whatever you desire. Lord, here's my life.
Hallelujah. Come on, let's give the Lord a shout of praise this morning. For his goodness, for his faithfulness. Isn't God like a surgeon? Isn't he like a surgeon on our lives? Precise, right? Can you imagine that? That we live in a day and age where it's you know, common for someone to experience heart surgery, brain surgery, and the precision that it takes to be delicate and yet cut so deep. And that's exactly like our Heavenly Father, to delicately cut so deep to turn us into who he needs us to be. He's got to remove things from our lives. He's got to remove things from our lives. And we could either be wiggling around trying to escape the bed, or we could just say, Lord, have your way. Take it out. It don't belong in me anyways. It's festering up, causing all kinds of other issues. It's yours, Lord. Have your way in me. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Amen, church. Well, you know, typically we go around and hug each other and all that good stuff, but we're going to have to do spiritual hugs still so that we can maintain safety with one another. So if you wouldn't mind, at least make some eye contact with somebody. That's a commodity these days, eye contact. Make some eye contact with somebody. Say hello. What's up? You could do a little South Bay head nod if you need to. Throw the head back. You know, it's all good before you are seated. And you may be seated. Together again on this beautiful Sunday that God has given us. Amen. Again, he provided the easiest easy up that any of us could ask for. We got a nice little shade covering this morning. So good call and coming to the 8 o'clock service, because this is about to burn off. You know it will. And you know, Mission Ebenezer, this is a tribe, isn't it, church? This is a tribe. And so part of the tribe is we have tribal moments, and many of those moments are important to us because we are the family of God, Mission Ebenezer Family Church. And so today we have one of those tribal moments. And what I would like to do is I would like to invite you to join me in giving a big round of applause and a welcome to Brother Solomon Bowie to come on up. Solomon, come on up, man. I'm not sure if he's being surprised or not right now, but come on up, brother. If you don't mind, you're standing right there. And I just want to share a couple of words about Brother Solomon Church. This is a young man who loves the Lord with his heart. This is a young man who God has had his hand upon and has great plans for. And this is his last Sunday worshiping with us here in California before he takes a trek
to the state next door, Arizona, where he will be playing football at Arizona Christian University, ACU. We're very proud of him. He's a humble man of God, very talented. In fact, if you are a fan of high school sports, particularly high school football, then you probably got really familiar with seeing his name show up in the Press Telegram, in the Daily Breeze, the LA Times, because he's gifted in many ways. Interceptions, tackles, you name it. This is a talented young man, but he walks in the covering of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he recognizes that no matter how talented he is, that his mom and dad have raised him with values, and the primary value is to put Jesus at the center of his heart. And so as he goes to play college football, he needs to know, church, that we got his back. He needs to know that we are proud of him and that we are praying for him, his safety, as well as the example that he will lead. As a former college football player myself, that is an opportunity. It's a mission field to be around 100 other guys coming from all different walks of life and spending day in and day out, every waking moment with this same group of guys. And let me tell you what, Solomon is going to have opportunity after opportunity to be a witness for Christ. He's going to have temptations around him, because those of us who've experienced college life know what that's like. But we're going to pray that the Lord will give him and allow him to stand on the firm foundation that he has been carried by up until this point. Amen, Solomon? So, church, I'm going to ask if you would just extend your hand in this direction. And we're going to say a prayer of blessing over Solomon as he gets ready to go and continue the Lord's work. And by the way, the last few Sundays that we've been here setting up chairs, he's been here at 6 a.m. making sure everything gets set up and helping out. For a young man, you know, of his age, to be doing that already demonstrates the kind of young man that he is. So let's pray a prayer of blessing over Solomon. Heavenly Father, we thank you for Solomon. We thank you for his life, for the amazing young man that he is turning out to be. We thank you that we've seen him since he was a little boy running around here in Royal Rangers and Vacation Bible School, Sunday School, and now he's a fine young man. And we pray, Father, that as you prepare to guide him to the next chapter in his journey in Arizona, that you would allow him to be an excellent student in the classroom, that you would guide his steps, that he would walk according to the ways of the godly, that he would lead an example for his teammates and friends, that you would surround him with a group of friends who love you and who want to live their lives in a way that brings honor to you. Would you protect him from the enemy's attacks? Would you give him physical safety as he competes, Lord? Be with his body, make him strong, fast, quick. Allow him, Father, to use his gifts to bring honor and glory to you. And would these few years that you've given to him to continue playing a sport that he loves be an opportunity for him to be shaped and molded into the man that you want him to be. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for his family who loves him, cares deeply about him, who will miss him, but who is very proud of him. And we pray that you would continue to watch over them as he goes as well. Lord, we bless him in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Solomon. Love you, brother. We look forward to reading about some good reports, Solomon. I was talking, some X's and O's with him last Sunday here on the asphalt, letting him know how to break into that lineup. And so we'll see if that comes in handy, giving him the tricks of the trade. But we're very proud of you, Solomon. Amen. So we are going to be starting a new series this morning, and we're going to be talking about the importance of being spirit-filled and spirit-led. Spirit-filled and spirit-led. But there's an interesting bridge and connection between where we've been in the Word of God on Sunday mornings and where we're headed, which is this morning we will be starting out this series in being spirit-filled by looking again to Galatians chapter 5. And we will be unpacking the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians. And so I would like to title this morning's message, A Spirit-Filled Home. A Spirit-Filled home. Can everybody say that with me? Everybody say a spirit-filled home. A spirit-filled home. What does it mean to have a spirit-filled home? What is it like to have the Holy Spirit invading our homes, covering them from wall to wall, from door to door, from bedroom to bedroom, from eating area to chilling area, from the garage to the driveway? What does it mean to have a spirit-filled home? Obviously, I'm talking about more than just a physical location. I'm talking about more than just wood, mortar, roofing. I'm talking about a family that is spirit-filled. How many of us want to have a spirit-filled family? And so I want us to take a look at the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians chapter 5, again, with a specific emphasis on a spirit-filled home. Galatians 5, 22 to 25. If you have your Bibles, you can follow along with me, or I'll read it as slowly and clearly as I can. I know many of you have devices and you follow along according to the scripture on your phones, which is awesome because I do the same thing. Galatians 5, 22. But the fruit of the Spirit. Somebody say fruit. Somebody say it again a little bit louder. Somebody say fruit. I don't know about you, but in the summertime, there's a lot of good fruit around here. In fact, yesterday, after a brief conversation with my neighbor, who lives by himself and he's retired, you know, it's amazing what a good conversation could do, because after just a couple minutes of connecting with him, the next thing you know, I come back outside and I find a grocery bag filled with about 12 to 14 freshly picked avocados. Man, just falling off the tree. You don't even know what to do with them. I know many of you are like, well, how come you didn't bring some this morning? Because I got guacamole plans, that's why. A whole lot of them. But this time of year, fruit is plentiful. And so, the fruit of the Spirit is, according to Galatians 5, love. When I say it, I want you to repeat it with me. Love. Joy. You can't say joy sadly. Come on, church. If you're going to say joy, you gotta say joy how joy needs to be said. You can't be like, joy. Okay? All right, we're going to try it again. Love. Joy. Peace. Patience. Kindness. Goodness. Faithfulness. Gentleness and self-control. If we just repeated that for the next 20 minutes, I think that would be a good enough word for us. Amen? But we won't do that. You could do that on your own time. The fruit of the Spirit, Paul says, are these things. I want you to imagine then that if these are called the fruit of the Spirit, I want you to imagine that the tree is the Spirit of God. And when we think of the tree being the Spirit of God, the evidence that the Spirit is there are these fruit. The evidence that the Spirit of God is moving are these characteristics and attributes that we just read. In other words, if you had a blindfold on and somebody brought to you a juicy, fresh picked pineapple, and you bit into that pineapple with your blindfold on, would you guess that you had just bit into an orange? Unless you lost your taste, which apparently is happening these days. Better watch out. If you can't taste something, you better call the hospital, okay? But if you have a blindfold on and you bite into a pineapple, you should know one way or another that that is a pineapple, right? If you bite into a banana, you're not going to think that it was an apple. In other words, wherever the Spirit of God is, there also is the fruit of the Spirit. My neighbors behind my dad's house as a kid, because, you know, back in the day, we didn't really care about boundaries and walls and fences. We would just, I'm so thankful they didn't have all those stand your ground things back when I was a kid, because I don't know if I'd be here by now. All the backyards that I've been in, trying to retrieve an errant baseball or a basketball or a football. And by the way, while I'm there, I'm going to take a look at this fig tree that my neighbor has. But there was this one fig tree that was huge, bigger than the olive tree right here in the middle of the rose garden in the horseshoe here at Mission Ebenezer. This tree was so big, and it had thousands of figs on them. And I remember being a kid, I love figs because my grandfather, Papich, had figs in his backyard as well. In fact, the story goes that as a kid, I used to always come in for dinner or lunch, and I wasn't hungry because there was enough fruit in the backyard that was feeding us. I didn't know that was called organic. Back then, it was just called eating what you see. And so I would try my neighbor's fig tree, and man, every time I'd take a bite of those figs, I'd have to spit them out because they were bitter, they were hard, they were green. And I wondered if that tree was like the tree that Jesus encountered when he cursed that fig tree. But that, anyway, this fig tree was bad. So the figs themselves are an indicator of the tree. The figs tell you the story that the tree is no good. And so when we think about what it means to live by the Spirit, I want you to ask yourself the question, what is the fruit of your life? When people and others taste of the fruit of your life, is it good? Is it sweet? Is it ripe? Or is it bitter? Is it unripened? And my prayer and hope is that we are the kind of people submitting to the Spirit of God whose fruit is good, whose life brings nourishment to others, starting in the home. You know, my grandfather, when he came from Mexico, took a trip over to Los Angeles Grand Central Market. Anybody ever been to the Grand Central Market in LA? Man, if you've never been to the Grand Central Market, right now might be a little difficult, but, you know, when the pandemic eases a bit, I encourage you to go, because if you're hungry, they got it. You want taquitos? They got it. You want a cheesesteak? They got it. Italian, Indian, American, Chinese, Korean, you name it, the Grand Central Market has it. You know, but what they also have, according to my grandfather, is a lot of pickpockets. A lot of, you know, people that are, you know, they're kind of, you know, they're looking to take somebody's wallet right out of their pocket, their smartphone. You know, you buy something at a store and you got to be careful because, you know, you got to watch your stuff. And so my grandfather, you know, shared with us that his first visit to the Grand Central Market, you know, a gentleman could tell that my grandfather was kind of new to the area, you know, in fact, new to the country. And this gentleman comes up to him, you know, speaking in Spanish, and he says, "Hey, are you new?" He says, "Yeah, my first time here." He goes, "Well, you got to be careful because people around here, they're, you know, they'll take whatever you have. You got to watch where you put your money and be careful where you're holding, you know, your items." And he goes, "There's people around here so good that they could take the socks off of your feet while not even taking your shoes off." And my grandfather looked at him and said, "Oh, okay, thank you. I appreciate the advice. But why are you holding your arm like that?" And he goes, "Oh, man, my watermelon." This brother got his watermelon taken from him. Was walking around like this. Okay, that's a joke. It's not a true story. Fruit of the Spirit. So my family loves fruit. My children love fruit. My Kaya, in fact, this guy will never stop eating strawberries and blueberries if you keep putting them in front of him. I don't think he has an end to, like, his system. He'll just keep throwing them in. Ruthie, she's all about the pineapple. She and I are pineapple on pizza kind of people. I know that that can cause a divide in our church right now. I'm trying not to cause those divisions. So if you're anti-fruit on pizza, my apologies to you. But I love me a good pineapple on a pizza, okay? With jalapeno, we're good to go. Joseph, okay, if he sees a mango, he's or an apricot or a peach, man, he'll go all day on those. Drea, okay, I'm just letting you know. I know some of you are friends with my wife and you love my wife, which is great. So if you ever want to make her happy, you know those fruit guys on the corner that chop up the fruit and throw it in with a little bit of lime and tahini and all that? That's her jam, right? I know if I'm trying to, like, if I do something bad and I'm trying to make up for it, I go get her a little bowl of fruit and then it's all good, right? She, like, forgives me immediately. Thank you. Thank you, babe. That's like our version of flowers, okay? At least you can eat them, you know what I mean? And then me, of course, mango, avocado, I already mentioned that. I'll go all day. But when you're looking at a good fruit, like, what do you determine? What are the things that you think of when you're trying to pick a good one, right? We think of things like color, things like size, texture, softness, and then, of course, taste, right? Ultimately, it's going to tell you whether or not something is good. And if you eat something, if you eat an orange that's good, what does it tell you about that tree? It tells you that if you pick another one that looks like the one you just ate, it's probably going to taste good also, and vice versa. If you pick a bad fruit, it's probably going to tell you that the next one that looks like it's supposed to be good is probably going to be bad. Why? Because a good tree produces good fruit. And a bad tree produces bad fruit. In fact, the Bible is filled with fruit imagery, believe it or not. Galatians 5 is not the first or last time that fruit is mentioned in the scriptures. And I want you to think about that. It's so down to earth, if you will. It's so rooted into the fabric of our existence that Jesus, and throughout the scriptures, all throughout the Old Testament and New Testament, uses this imagery. Let me give you a couple examples. Psalm 1 says this: "Blessed is he who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the company of mockers. But the one who delights in the law day and night, that person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither, and whatever they do prospers." Psalm 1 is a great reminder to us that when we are rooted in God, when we are living in the Spirit, that means that in season and out of season, our life is constantly bearing fruit. I love that it says it's planted by rivers of water. Why? Because we know that in order for something to be plentiful, it needs to have a number of different elements that are at place. And we're going to get into those in a little bit. But I want you to also take a look at Psalm 34, verse 8, which says, "Taste and see that the Lord is good." Taste and see that the Lord is good. In other words, our lives and how we live should be nourishment to our family, should be nourishment to the world. Unfortunately, if we are not surrendered to the work of the Spirit in our lives, then what we can be giving off is that of unripened fruit. Bitter fruit. We could be giving a bad name to the tree that we come from. But I don't know about you, I'd rather be the kind of person that when somebody's a little bit weak, when somebody's a little bit tired, when somebody's a little bit hungry, they could reach out and they're going to get love. They could reach out, they're going to get a little bit of joy. They could reach out, they're going to get a little bit of peace. They could reach out, they're going to get a little bit of patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. John 15 is another area that talks a lot about fruit. Jesus says, "I am the vine, you are the branches," Jesus says. "And the Father, my Father, is the gardener." And he says, every branch that bears fruit is going to get pruned up so that it could bear even more fruit. And Jesus says, every branch that doesn't bear good fruit is going to get cut off so that the nutrients can go to the branches that are producing fruit. So as we enter into this conversation about the fruit of the Spirit, I want us to remember that God has created us to bear good fruit. And that if we want to bear even more fruit, right, then we need to live our lives in such a way that produces. Live our life in such a way that the gardener comes and says, "Ooh, that one's doing good. Let's cut around it so that that one can get a little bit more water, nutrient, sunlight," right? So when the Spirit of God fills us up, and we surrender to the work of God in our heart, number one, it nourishes our household. It nourishes our household. And number two, our home becomes nourishment for the world. Our home as a spirit-filled home becomes nourishment for the world. Let me talk a little bit about each of these individually. So first, nourishing our household through the fruit of the Spirit. The first one that Paul talks about here is love. Love. The fruit of love. The fruit of love in our homes is irreplaceable. See, the interesting thing about it is when we think about generations and generational patterns that we inherit and that we pass on, oftentimes we give out what we've received. If we've received hate, guess what we give out? If we've received rejection, guess what we give out? If we've received being let down before, and if we've received being forgotten before, well, that's what we give out. Right? Because when we're part of that tree, we talk about a family tree. When we're part of that tree, we oftentimes will simply reproduce that which we've been given. But the Spirit of Christ is such that intervenes and breaks the chains and curses of generational bondage. That when we surrender to the Spirit of God's work in our lives, then all of a sudden we are supernaturally and miraculously able to give that which we never received before. So you don't have to say, oh, well, that's all I've ever seen in my home, so that's why I am the way I am. Well, that's what my dad did to me, so that's why I am the way that I am. Well, that's how my mom treated me, so that's how I am the way that I am. When the Spirit of God intervenes, all of a sudden, all those things are stopped up like a dam. All those patterns are left behind and in our past, and the Spirit of God gives us something brand new so that we are able to give that which we maybe never received before. So if you never got the love you thought you deserved, guess what? You can give it because God has more than enough for every single one of us, no matter where you're from, no matter what you've been through, no matter how much you feel like you've been left in the dust, no matter how low you feel like you've gotten in your life, no matter what you feel like you don't have, God has more than enough of it to fill up your cup and have some available for those around you. So before you say, man, I don't know how to love, what I would say is this: sure you do, because God's love has filled your heart if you've surrendered your life to it. He's got more than enough. He can make up for what you feel like you didn't get. I don't know if you believe that or not, church. For some people, that might be hard to believe. Some people might be thinking, man, there's no way that I could easily be healed from some of the things that I've had to go through in my childhood and in my life. And what I want to say to you is this: I believe that we serve a God who can do impossible things. If we place our faith and our trust in Him and we surrender to Him, then He can take broken things and make them healed again. He could take wounded things and make them well again. God can do miracles, and He can do them today. Well, probably the greatest miracle that He could do is a miracle of the heart. You know, people get over preoccupied with physical miracles, when in reality, I think the greatest miracle is when somebody who never had love before is able to produce it because a good God intervened and let them start on a new track that they'd never been introduced to before. So love, my friends, is available for you. Plenty of it. Oceans of it. He's a good God. Full of love. In fact, there's a few times in Scripture that give God a metaphor, a direct metaphor. And one of those is God is love. So there's enough love for you. Love, agape, right? The second one is joy, joy. The word for joy in Greek here is kara. So I don't know if any of you have a friend named Kara, but it actually comes from the word joy. Joy. In fact, I'll throw this in there really quickly because, again, this is another tribal moment. But many of you know Brother Gabe Rocha, who served here in ministry for a number of years. Dad is Mitch and Rocha, and Mom Rosie Rocha. This weekend, he's engaged now. He's an engaged young man. He's going to get married. And his fiance's name is Kara. So it made me think of this word, Kara. Joy. See, the thing about joy as a fruit of the Spirit that we have access to, that not only can we eat from, but we can produce and allow that to hang from us, the branches of our lives for others, is it goes much deeper than temporary things like pleasure. Joy and pleasure are two very different things. You know, we live in a world that constantly seeks pleasure but has no joy. And I want to encourage you today, church, to lean into and receive the joy of the Lord. In fact, the Word of God says the joy of the Lord is our strength. So if you're feeling weak, if you're feeling discouraged, well, guess what? Get a little bit of joy of the Lord. How do you get the joy of the Lord? Begin to notice God in the little things. Begin to notice God at work in the little things. When a hummingbird flies by, look at it and say, wow, man, isn't our God beautiful? When you see the color of grass right now, when it gets the right amount of water and sun, you look at that vibrant green and you say, man, isn't our God good? You look up and see a blue sky poking through the cloud cover and the marine layer, and you say, isn't our God beautiful? Joy is noticing God in the little things. Love, joy, peace. Somebody say peace. In fact, our worship leader, Nena Irene, her name means peace. Peace. Not worried, not afraid, not at war with myself or others. Peace. The peace of God surpasses understanding. The fruit of the Spirit that's available for us. How many of us want peace? That kind of peace. Kind of peace that allows us to sleep when we need to sleep, work when we need to work, play when we need to play. Peace of God. Patience. The word for patience here is really means enduring hardship, or like some versions of the Bible say, long suffering. What does that mean? That means we are not easily perturbed or disturbed, but we can hang in there for a while. That's a characteristic of God. That we could go through it a little bit, especially when it's on behalf of somebody else. That's a fruit of the Spirit. Kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Man, we can go on and on each of these categories. But the last thing that I want to simply remind us of is that as we discuss fruit, good fruit, fruit of the Spirit, a Spirit-filled home, a home that's filled with these kinds of fruit, a home where our children can easily reach up and get a little bit of love and joy and can learn about self-control and goodness, a home where those things are being instilled over and over again, where they're being corrected and where they're being taught and modeled for our family so that they can pass that on to their friends and their children, a home where the fruit of the Spirit is plentiful. When we think of that kind of fruit, we have to remember that it's not easy to get good fruit. You don't just all of a sudden show up and get 20 avocados on my doorstep. Man, somebody had to plant that seed. Right now we have an avocado seed growing and we're watching the root come out in the cup of water. I don't know if you ever YouTube that or Googled that, but we're having fun. I don't know if we're actually going to be successful with this sucker, but it's a fun process at least for now. But it takes a lot of work. And then you got to plant it. Then you got to make sure it has what it needs. It's got the right amount of sun and shade. It's got the right kind of soil, got the right amount of water, right? Got to make sure it doesn't have the wrong kind of bugs around it, right? You might need to treat it every once in a while. There's a lot that goes into preserving something so that you can have good fruit. And I want to remind us that just as the Holy Spirit is after creating in us the ability to produce the fruit of the Spirit in our lives over and over again, the enemy's trying to take that away. The enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. So as we talk about a Spirit-filled home and a home that is filled with the fruit of the Spirit, let's be aware, constantly aware, of the enemies, the pests that are coming in. Pests like being tired. It's hard to have joy when we're tired. Being hungry, lonely, afraid, when we feel unappreciated, when we're feeling bitter or anger, when we're feeling sadness, coldness, greed, selfishness, resentment, depression, pride, egocentrism, all of these things make it very difficult to give love, to practice joy, peace, patience. So we got to check our heart. Is there soil in there for good fruit? Or is the pH level a little bit off? Am I allowing too much shade and not enough light to come in? Is it being drowned out by the worries of the world? Or has it got just the right amount of water? Are the locusts and the bugs, the caterpillars, the roly-polies coming in to eat through all of our good fruit? We got to be aware. Amen? So as we continue in this series of a spirit-filled home, this week I want to encourage you, church, for those joining us online, for those who are here in person, I want you to think about yourselves as a fruit inspector for the week. I think about yourself walking through the rows of the trees in your orchard, taking a look to see if the color is looking good, taking a look to see if there's something growing on there that shouldn't be growing. I want you to do a fruit inspection of your life and of your home, and maybe ask the Lord, God, where the fruit of the Spirit is lacking, give me the courage and the ability to work hard to turn it in the other direction, to not just allow the pest to take over in my garden. Lord, give me the ability, the wisdom to see what I need to see and to do what I need to do to make sure that good fruit is coming from my life and from my home. Amen? Would you join me? I'm going to invite up Pastor Dan Hudson, who's going to bring us to a close this morning and also lead us through a time of communion.
What a great word from Pastor Koba this morning. Yeah. The sun is out. Good challenge, Pastor Koba. Well, I know there's a lot of yelling that happens in my house. And sometimes I think my windows are too big. Our house may be known for something other than what you just preached about, but it's a good challenge. I also know that I've got three children, and two of them are right here, and I know that in many ways that's a fruit of the Spirit, because I know the love and the Spirit that they have within them, and it makes me feel good that that's an extension of the fruit from my home. I do take your word that you've given us today to be a good challenge, to check the fruit in our house. Certainly want it to be known on Fern Avenue that fruit comes from that home. Look forward to the series. I hope you all are looking forward to the series as well. And find your way back here or online so we can continue to be built up in God's word and in his Spirit, the truth, to know who we are as people of God. Who we are as people of God are people that partake of his body and his blood. And we're going to transition a little bit now into taking communion together. It's been a while. I don't know about for you, but it was something I look forward to on a regular basis. And when you're streaming, you get creative, you do it at home, and if you're at home, please find a way. Here we are this morning, and I hope each of you got our little communion cup, the blessing that it is. It's got layers to it. So if you can figure out the puzzle, we're going to open it up, and you got the wafer right there at the top, and then you open it up again, and you got the juice. This guy said one time that life's like an onion. You peel it away one layer at a time. And sometimes you weep. Onions do make you cry. And our lives, I'm sure, have had layers taken off, and we weep from that. But when we hear a word about the Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit that's within us, isn't it a joy to think about the layers of our life being peeled away? And we see these amazing descriptions of the fruit, the love, the peace, the joy, the kindness, the self-control, Those layers exist in us. Why? If you keep looking for that self in you as you pull those layers away, you'll keep weeping until you get to the point and you know at the core is the presence of Jesus Christ, the salvation that we have. So that is what we're going to participate in now. Everybody have the wafer and the cup. See if I can open mine up here. Getting close. So our Lord was at his last meal with his closest friends, surrounded by men who had been intimate with his teachings, with his love, the presence of God in their midst. At this final time together, the good, the bad, and the ugly were all there. Jesus took a moment to break bread with them and share a cup that was reflective of so much that means so much to us today. Every one of us has been welcomed to the table. And as you think about your heart and its brokenness and its closeness to God, that opportunity is made real today as we take the body and blood of Jesus, knowing the sacrifice that's been made for us. The blood shed for each and every one of our sins, the body broken for our healing and wholeness that allows us to know about the joy, the fruits that are ours. So the word is, for I received from the Lord that which I passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." You may take the bread. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." You may take the cup. So, Lord, as we have enjoyed the company of your presence, the gift of your word that has shed a light on our lives, the opportunity in this gathering to enjoy your body and your blood and know the healing and the fullness of life that come from that, we are so blessed today and grateful. Pray that each of us would do as the word has been shared. Be that fruit of goodness to others around us, that our home and our lives would be a blessing to those whom we cross paths with, who we come alongside, who we work and fight with, that this fruit would ultimately be that which is what we're known by. Thank you for that blessing. How blessed we are. So as we bring our service to a close, after a few announcements, we are grateful, God, for this day that you have made. And as we rejoice and are glad in it, we walk out with this blessing and receive it from you with great hearts of joy and gratitude. We leave today blessed and better than the way we came. And in that, we we pray in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And everybody said, amen. So with this fine music going on behind me, I just want to make sure that we know that we have an opportunity to participate online with our midweek Bible study at 6:30 p.m. in Spanish, 7:30 in English. You can find that online. And also know that these services will be restreamed 5 p.m. tonight. 5 p.m. tonight will be the English service, 6:30 p.m. Spanish. So if you want to get a little bit more out of what Pastor Koba shared, be close to this event or let others know. Those times are important. Please make sure that you register for next week's services and also be mindful of our tithes and offerings. You have the envelopes that are in your programs. Those can be put in the wood boxes at the back. Also, we always have the PayPal opportunity. Let us be faithful in our giving. How blessed we are to have a powerful church like this. Men and women of God, be blessed and go in the name of Jesus. Have a good day. Amen.